conclude our pop-up exhibition series this semester with a talk by Agnieszka Iwińska. And it's a conversation about memory and memory through oral history, which is a very, very particular kind of history, and a history that's very important when places are abandoned or destroyed, and when populations are either destroyed or relocated. So it's actually a very important topic in general in our days. There are recent calculations that say that about 1/7 of the world population is now in transit, in movement. So collecting those stories is essential to memory, to history, our shared sense of history. So just that's to place this conversation in a broader perspective. But we also have in this series a very topical perspective, which is that we connect a speaker, and I think many of you are here also because you know the speaker, but our speaker today has been working as an intern for Public Philanthropies, but she's also been doing a lot of research with Yiddish-speaking Jews from Poland, so the topic, Love in the Ruins, Jewish Life in Norris, it's based on her research, and we're going to listen to her right away. But we put our speakers in connection with an item or items from the Magnus collection. And in this case, we have on display a watercolor by Meyer Kirschenblatt. The late Meyer Kirschenblatt was the father of the noted Jewish studies scholar, anthropologist, and curator of the Polin Museum in Warsaw, Barbara Kirschenblatt England. And at some point in his life, Meyer, whose nickname was Meyer Tammuz, from the month of Tammuz, because he was a very feisty young man, and Tammuz is a month in the summer, July, so in English would be Meyer July, a feisty young man, but at some point in his life, he picked up painting. And what his daughter, the anthropologist, did is that she didn't just let him paint. She actually interviewed him many, many times over to try and extract his memories of childhood. He left Poland before the Holocaust. So his fresh memories through painting of his childhood in Poland. He grew up in the town of Opatov, or Apt in Yiddish. And so this painting actually, which is a little gruesome, right? It's the title is Shaving the Corpse, comes with a story. So I will just share with you the story that will give you a sense of why we created this connection and why our talk today and the painting really fit very well with one another. A story is told in the Apt Memorial Book about a rich man in Apt who abandoned most of his religion. These are the words of Meyer July, Meyer Kirschenblatt, who then painted the scene. One day, the famous rabbis in the city called all the Jewish barbers together and made them swear a solemn oath not to shave the beards of any Jews. So the man asked the Gentile barber to shave off his beard and sidebones. The rabbi often berated this man, warning him of what might befall him for this transgression. The man went around clean-shaven in a top hat and fashionable clothes rather than in traditional Jewish cap and long coat. He was a modernized one, right? He only attended the synagogue once a year for Kol Nidre on the eve of Yom Kippur. One day he got sick. He was bedridden for several months. During this time, his beard grew back. He finally passed away. When the rabbi learned of his death, he decreed that before the body could be interred, the beard had to come off. This man had to appear in front of the Lord, looking just the way he did when he was alive, without a beard. The rabbi ordered the body brought into the synagogue courtyard, and the man's face lathered and shaved. So it was done. They shaved the corpse. And since it took place before my time, recounts my original, I read about it in the memorial book from my town. So these are memories of memories, and then painted memories of a Polish Jewish childhood. They became an exhibition that debuted at Magnus in 2007, and then it's been touring around the world. And they're also collected, so the images and the stories in a book called They Call Me Marriage Lie. It was jointly published by the former Judah Magnus Museum and the University of California Press. But now, really, without any further ado, let's welcome our speaker. Thank you so much for being here today.
Thank you very much. thank you very much for coming, and I absolutely agree with all the words that Francesco shared with you. I would like to start with a very personal message. I am a granddaughter of Poles who were expelled from Lithuania in 1956, and I am also a great-great-granddaughter of Poles who were expelled from Russia in the 1881 after the bomb attack on the Tsar Alexander II that one of my family members committed. So the story of expulsion is imprinted in my family history. And I was born in Gdansk, that used to be Danzig, in a house that belonged to German Jews. I grew up in a town called Giżycko, that used to be called Lutzen, in a house of Germans, with German books, with German encyclopedia. My very first geography lesson, in fact, was taken in German by my father. I chose to study in Wrocław, that used to be Breslau, before the Second World War, and only in 1945 became a Polish city that I can be proud of as part of my heritage, but not to forget the heritage of people who used to live there before. And unfortunately, I wasn't privileged to live in Wrocław in houses that used to belong to Germans, because Wrocław was destroyed in almost 97% by Germans and Russians during the Second World War, and then by Poles during the reconstructions. Because the decision what to forget and what to remember, I think, is the key decision that every one of us takes, always. It's a choice. Memory is given, but it's also taken. And then what we decide to pass to the next generation, sometimes it's a very self-conscious decision, but sometimes it's just complete coincidence. And probably people who are doing archaeology or ancient history here in the audience, they understand this the most, because this what we have today from the very ancient time is this what people from the very generations decided to pass to us and give us as a gift from the people before. I became oral historian by accident. I didn't plan to be oral historian. This is just something that happened in my life. And I don't want to really talk about this, because that's not something that I yet considered. So I don't have an answer. That's why I'm doing oral history. And coming into this very important for me subject, Jews in the Lower Silesia, I would like to give you a brief background about those about whom I will not talk today, about the German Jews, the people who lived in Wrocław and Lower Silesia before the Jews that I am interested in came and started to settle. The subject is called Love in the Ruins, Jewish Life in Lower Silesia, 1945-1968. But for a moment, we will step back for a few years before that time.
Get closer to the mic.
This map is just to give you the general background where we are. Breslau, as it was mentioned before, that used to be a Breslau German city, later became Wrocław, with the population of 20,000 Jews approximately in the early 30s. But this number is not correct. The people, the population that I am familiar with, given by Ivo Encyclopedia, is 25,000 people. Lower Silesia is this whole region up to the Czech Republic border. So you can see this starting with Breslau, Wrocław, going a little bit towards the west and then down. This is the Lower Silesia. German Jews lived in Breslau until 1945 and a few years later. The last expulsion of the Jews, by the way, happened in Germans and German Jews happened in Poland in 1956. Which gives also 11 years after the war. Population was really strong, very high educated, wonderful people, highly involved in the city life. Some of them were governors, and most of them were academics, lecturers, doctors, lawyers. very important people for the city populations. The oldest gravestone in Breslau comes from 2021, and it's a proof that the community was already very strong because it's imprinted in stone, saying that here lies the son of Hazan. So that means that the community was already strong 800 years ago. So it's a long story. Today in Wrocław remained two cemeteries, very big one, very beautiful one, by Ślęża Street and Lutnicza Street, often with German inscriptions, but some of them also have Hebrew letters or mixed. And this is the place that it's really worth to study for itself. Ślęża Cemetery started in late 18th century, but really developed by the whole 19th century until the 20th. The gravestones that remained after the war are just a small percent of the beautiful square that used to took a lot of space in Wrocław. Unfortunately, Maciejewicz gravestones were used to ground the roads, as it happened in many other places. Lutnicza Street Cemetery is used by the Jewish community until today. Ślęża remained as a museum, as an artifact of itself, but by Lutnicza Street, the last person was buried just a year ago. 1938 is really the day when the German-Jewish destruction started, just a year before Polish Jews' destruction began. Kristallnacht destroyed many synagogues, many beautiful buildings, including the one that you can see here by Kruja Street. In Wrocław today there's the only one synagogue left. Gruss Rosen, that's the name that not often is heard in the dialogue of and in conversation of in the Holocaust studies, but it's very important concentration camp, and it was also a mass murder place for equal number than in other places, especially in concentration camps in Germany. But somehow wasn't lucky enough to get enough interest from scholars, so probably because its location is very difficult to reach, so not many people are visiting this place, but it is very important, and it plays a key role in the story that I would like to share with you. And this Arbeit macht frei, of course, it was an inscription on every concentration camp, so this picture comes from Gross Rosen, it's not from Auschwitz. Just to give you a sense how big was Gross Rosen. If you visited Auschwitz, then you could see a place that was settled on a side of a town. It's huge. It gives you an impression of its own size. Gross Rosen is spread around in small places. So Gross Rosen itself in the small town of Radziejów is not so big, but with this whole small little parts that belong to the main camp, it's huge really, because it covered up the whole Lower Silesia. So almost every town that is today part of Lower Silesia was a concentration camp for people who perished during the war. And that's something what people don't like to remember, because who likes to live in a place where it used to be concentration camp? Like for example in Ludwigsdorf, just nearby the border with Czech Republic, where was a chemical factory for female workers. None of them could, those who survived, none of them could have children after the war. They were all very young, in the age between 20 and 40. To me, this what we choose to remember is also an act of resistance. And I want to remember also about the filias of Gross Rosen, that's why I'm sharing this with you today. And now something optimistic. Optimistic and not, but actually it is optimistic. Before the war in Poland, we had 3.5 million Jews, as we quote this number. In 1945, the number that was registered in the Jewish committees was 100,000. In 1946, 250,000. That's the number that is quoted by the Jewish Historical Institute based on research of many scholars. 250,000 people. Where from? How come they got back to Poland? If we think that nobody survived, then where these people came from? Well, thanks to Jakob Egid. Jakob Egid, Jacob Egid, as he is known by his name written on the book called Grand Illusion, the story of the Lower Silesian Jews. In 1945, May 9th, he discovered 5,000 survivors from the Gross-Rosen concentration camp. And that's the reason why I mentioned Gross-Rosen. He was thrilled to know that that these people are there and that they want to stay in the Lower Silesia and that they see potential opportunity to build a new Jewish life. He connected with Antek Zuckerman, a ghetto fighter from the Warsaw ghetto, and they both did a field trip which took 3 days of very intensive discussion in which they made a decision that yes, they would like Jews to stay in Poland. Yes, it will be Lower Silesia, as it is called in Yiddish Niederschlesie and in Polish Dolny Śląsk. And yes, as Antek Zuckerman insists, there will be also kibbutz for people who would like to work hard and live to Palestine. But also there will be an opportunity to preserve the old Yiddish culture for those who would like to do it. Because in the small towns like Wałbrzych, Dzierżoniów, Legnica were left synagogues that people could use. And that was the final closing down argument. So the religious aspect also played back then a key role for people who decided to build the new life. I didn't mention Wrocław, Breslau, and I didn't for a purpose. 1945, Wrocław looked like this. No water, no heat, no clothes, no place to live, only ruins. And actually, even until 1946, you could see here and there the fire, which was very difficult to stop from spreading around. 1 full year of total destruction of the city. Only in 1947, the proper settlement in Wrocław started to take place. And that was the moment when the Gross-Rosen survivors moved out from Dzierżoniów, Rychbach, Reichenbach, as it was called in Yiddish and in German, and then Rychbach in Yiddish, to Wrocław with the Jewish community. Jakob Egid worked really hard to encourage as many as possible Jews who survived in Soviet Union to come to Poland and stay in Lower Silesia and then also Pomerania up north in city Szczecin and neighborhood Stettin as it is in German. He succeeded to some extent. Some people, I know from many stories that some people were very enthusiastic and they were hoping that finally, they will stay in Poland, not their own Poland, but at least they will be able to speak Polish language. What to me, as a Pole, was very moving testimony. My grandparents also came on a train like this from Lithuania in 1956, and that was my personal connection to dig deeper in the Jewish story, because I was thinking, what if they had in the same courage Jewish neighbors from Soviet Lithuania. How did they behave? I don't have answers for that, unfortunately, because they passed away, but I like to hear other voices, and based on that maybe to build an image for our common history, the Polish-Jewish one. Beginning wasn't easy, unfortunately, because in 1946, Yaakov Egit expected, he was the chairman of the Jewish committee in the whole Lower Silesia, he expected transports from Soviet Union to come only in June, and they arrived in February. So imagine the situation, February, Poland, very cold, nothing was really prepared, and people had to stay where they had to stay. Some of them, they had to share apartments with Germans, with German Jews, with Polish neighbors, and some of them had to stay in concentration camps in this filias of Gross-Rosen, because there was still some place at least to have a roof above your head. So beginning really wasn't easy. 1946 was the key year when many people decided to leave as fast as they could, even if some of them really wanted to stay in Poland because they spoke only Polish language or Polish and Russian. So what can you do if you speak Polish and Russian? Definitely not to go to Palestine, because Palestine means Hebrew. Sweden, that means Swedish. France, that means French. America, that means English. But nonetheless, despite of the difficulties and very, very tricky life condition, they started to build life immediately. And in 1945, in the newspaper, the Desnaye Leben, that started to be published in June 1945, you could read that we have 33 books, we can start library. In 1947 was opened Jewish theater in Wrocław with the most famous probably Jewish actress, Ida Kamińska. She played a key role in the cultural life. She and her husband, Zygmunt Turkow, his brother, Jonas Turkow. So they were the people who encouraged such a star as Molly Picon to come and visit around neighborhoods, to check up with her friends, and to write a beautiful story about visiting Lower Silesia. Jews took amazing care of children, which was very important, especially for those who survived in extremely difficult circumstances, like people who couldn't walk, who didn't have enough vitamin D, and who simply were in very bad shape. So with the help from JOINT, the American Jewish Committee, it was possible to start safe places, especially for children. And that's another aspect that is really moving for me in times of in this time that we live, where we have so many refugees and we talk about what to do with children, that the Jewish orphans, often left alone, they had amazing, wonderful care, not only from the Jewish side, but also Polish side and German. Because you probably don't know that, but many German women who stayed in the Lower Silesia alone because husbands were taken or in prison or they were killed during the war, they didn't want to move to Germany until they were forced. They played a key role in taking care of the Polish and Jewish children after the war in the very first years. They were often nannies, piano teachers, or personal carers after the war. Germans, Poles, and Jews together, immediately after the war, where you have to put the hate back and start the new life. And you just do it because you have to. To me, it was a personal lesson when I read personal documents. Also, employing Germans as a cleaning ladies was an act of humiliation towards them. High educated, classy, very elegant. It was often seen as a moment of proudness that yes, we won this war. Yaakov Egit, whom I already mentioned, he wrote and published in 1947 in a great hurry a book called Zu einer Leben, Zweijor Jiddische Bischof in Niederschlesia. And this book is seen as very constitutional for the Lower Silesia. He published this for the purpose of JOINT mainly, asking for money, but also to inform Western world about lowers the vision, a great power of the possibilities to stay and build the new life of the useful Jews for Poland. So a key word back then was produktivizacja, usefulness, something that scholars may associate with a Russian story when Jews wanted to get the jobs that weren't traditionally associated with Jewish aspects. And this book was very popular back then, by the way. And based on that, Nathan Gross, produced, directed, and presented a movie called Jüdische Niederschlesien in 1947, and I will just share with you a very short piece, just to give you a background, because this movie is in Yiddish and without English subtitles, so not to exclude anyone.
Sie würde hier wunderschöne Berge, Felder, Weingärten, seine gewinnt jedes von die samme schrecklichste Verbrechen. Als er würde hier Ganeden, ist gewinnt ein Gehirn, Paris. Weil er für Niederschlesien ist gewesen am Gedichtsfluss verfleckt mit Konzentrationslagern. Walbschöch, Djerzhon, Fidelava, Venglovnia und zähnliche andere. Die erdnidusige Erde ist durchgewegt mit jüdisch Blick, die Luft zerrissen von jüdischen Geschrehen. Aber die Verbrecher sind nicht ausgemitten, die verdiente Strophe. Der deutsche Udler ist wie ein Scherb zerklappt geworden. Der Hackenkreis zertreten geworden, wie ein mieser Spitz. Die Städte sind geworden Chur. Die einzige Einwohner von die verwiste Erde sind geworden die Befreite von die Konzentrationslager, so das Röte See, Jid. Sie sind in das Gewinn die erste aufzuleben, die aufgestorbene Stimme. Aber es ist nicht gewesen von der leichten Sachen. Die riesige Fabrikhalle, die Maschinen sind geworden zerstört und zerfressen zu Jabber. Nicht besser haben wir uns gesehen, die verloste Häuser, wo es umgewalt, auf neue Balabatten. Aber auf den Wegen in Polen haben sie schon gezogen, zehnziger Schalonen mit jüdischen Repatrianten und Rattenverwandten. Das ist gewesen eine entscheidende Zeit. Die Repatrianten haben schnell gebeten, das heute in Niederschlesien.
This movie is available for free on YouTube, so if anyone would like to see the full movie, then I'm very happy to share the link to this movie with you. Important but very forgotten by the modern history place was Dzierżoniów, a few times mentioned on this movie, because Dzierżoniów was originally the very first place for the Jewish settlement. Imagine this, in 1945, Dzierżoniów, by the end of 1945, in December, it was the largest Jewish settlement in post-war Europe, by having 25,000 Jews living there. Of course, the synagogue was built by German Jews and survived luckily by cleverness of the Jewish community, because Karol Springer, who was the man kind enough to make an agreement with the Jewish community, he was a German officer who bought symbolically from the Jewish community the whole building. And because it was a German possession, Germans didn't destroy this building, although it was a Jewish synagogue. So here is the example that even in the times of alienness, cooperation makes sense and has a physical impact on the community that will come after. So the generation thinking and seeing things in big picture really makes sense. The photo below shows the Jewish community celebrating Rosh Hashanah in 1946. This is the Jewish synagogue under the White Stork in Wrocław. I believe this photo comes from early 80s. The synagogue survived only because German soldiers, Nazis, they were afraid that if they would put fire under, it will spread to the old town that Breslau was very proud of, and which is just a few streets across from this building. So very practical reasons saved this building. And this is how it looks today, through the effort of Norwegian singer Bente Kahan. And of course, many people with open hearts. And that's the place where I spent a great moments in the past 10 years, coming and going here. Today, the synagogue plays more role as a cultural center rather than a synagogue of itself, although for very important events like high holidays, still is full of people who are coming to celebrate. And here we are coming to the real topic after this general background of this unknown history of the Lower Silesia. Memory, as Francesco said, plays the key role, especially today in this very dangerous time. And today is May 3rd. May 3rd is the day that in Poland we celebrate Constitution. Second in the world after American, first in Europe, established in 1791 by Poles and proclaimed proudly by Poles in the past. And I would like to say a word about this because we are in Berkeley, because I have microphone, because I can do it. I feel ashamed for this, what's going on today in my own country. And as an oral historian, I wish history wasn't repeating itself so fast, so quickly, so dramatically, and so rapidly the way as it does. Yesterday, when in Poland we celebrated the flag holiday, March of ONR, which is our national organization, the same one who was responsible for beating Jews from coming to university in the 30s, as we know very well from the history, was proclaimed a legal organization celebrating 83 years of its own existence. I'm saying this to you now because we are looking at Henryk Robak, a man who inspired me to do oral history. He was, he is a survivor of Warsaw Ghetto. He was officer in the Soviet Army during the Second World War. He's a Holocaust survivor who decided to come to Poland after the Second World War. And after seeing Warsaw, his own home city in ruin, he moved to Wrocław, continuing his career as a soldier. He is a former communist, and he never stopped to believe that communism makes sense. And I met him in 2007 as a student at the University of Wrocław. And he made a great impression on me because I was thinking, why this man is still here? Why this man is coming to events that are not really related to his own interest? But he explained me that memory is this what we choose to have. So he chose to take care of 9 photo albums presenting the Jewish life after the war in the Lower Silesia. Why 9? They were prepared in the years of 1945-1948. They were presenting the Jewish life of the Lower Silesia. 9 because each album has its own purpose. One is for the very personal community possession, one is to ask joint for more money, one is to the communist government, one was for other communities to show what we are doing, who we are, from the best side, so just to hide clothing problems, food problems, apartment problems, but also sometimes to mention that if you could help kindly, we will accept your help. So Henryk Robak is a person to whom we are very grateful to have a knowledge and a photo documentation, which is also a key role in the work of historians when we work and when we try to rebuild reconstruct, not rebuild, but reconstruct the memory of the place and people. Because personal documents, as much as they are very important, they often not reflect the full state of mind of the government, as the official papers do and have the power to. And I would like to share with you a piece of interview, it's in Yiddish and with subtitles, that Krista Whitney and I from the Yiddish Book Center recorded with Henrik Robach during our field trip to Poland in 2012.
Ich muss fragen, von was hat geblieben da in Breslau, weil es auch jeden seinen Weg?
Von was bin ich geblieben? Das ist eine Frage, nicht nur von wie, von wie jeden welche seinen geblieben. Ich bin geblieben, ich habe trotzdem gehabt, nicht mit der jüdischen Frau, der polnischen Frau, die verbinden. Und zweitens, nach dem Ruhme, in Breslau, sind aufgestanden jüdische Organisationen. Sie sind aufgestanden die jüdische Kultur, ein jüdischer Komitee. In Europa sind aufgestanden solche jüdische Gesellschaften, heißt es, dass sie dort schon. Und ich bin geblieben als Jid, welcher kennt sich pagan, nicht pagan mit der jüdischen Sprache, mit der jüdischen Kultur, bin ich geblieben. Und ich habe ungeheuer normal meine gesellschaftliche Arbeit in der Richtung der jüdischen Kultur. Du in Breslau. Ich habe ungeheuer, wenn es so existiert, der jüdische Kulturverband, Basinde, der Komitee Basinde. Ich habe noch für jüdischen Kulturverband, ich habe nicht mitgenommen, gewisse Beschreibungen, welche sind herausgegangen. Dadurch ist auch gestanden das jüdische Buch. Verspreiten das jüdische Buch in Polen. Du in Breslau. Nur ich bin gewesen, in dem will ich auch verspreite das jüdische Buch, du zwischen Jeden. Ich bin gewesen, der muss auch die gebildete jüdische Dose an jüdische Bibliothek, auch das ist als jüdische Bücher. Der gesammelt normale Bücher, du. Nur wir haben auch ein paar Kämen für Nordland Bücher. Sagt mir, ob wir kommen von Deutschland, jüdische Bücher.
Henrik Robach, luckily, is still alive, still with us, and he is still the chair of this Jewish organization called TSKZ, Towarzystwo Społeczno-Kulturalne Żydów w Polsce, Cultural and Society Association for the Jews in Poland. I will see him next month in Wrocław. And he was my personal first inspiration to find out more about the history of the Jews in the Lower Silesia. Henrik Robach is very uninspiring one. He doesn't like to share stories. He probably maybe not even like people so much. He does not talk, you have to make a very special appointment with him on the Tuesday 12 o'clock. If you are 15 minutes late, forget the conversation. You may try on Thursday, but it may not be possible because he may not come. But he is the one who says that it is important to stay, and I did this because it was important for me. Others who stayed, because yes, they are others who stayed, said that, oh, I stayed because where to go, anti-Semitism, yeah, you can deal with anti-Semitism. I heard from my American friends that there is also some anti-Semitism here. Israel, yes, you have to speak Hebrew, so we just decided to stay. I thought that maybe they are excuses, maybe they were just fake answers. What is the real reason? And after coming and going, I really understood that the real reason is that these people really love the place where they live. It took me years to come into that conclusion. A few years of conversations, discussions, recordings in Israel, Germany, Poland, United States, Canada, asking questions, writing emails, collecting altogether so far 87 stories and moving along with them. But when I see the picture like this of these smiling girls on Włodkowice Street that back then in the early 50s was a street in ruins, I can't stop thinking that that love plays a role in some decisions that we make. Sometimes it's a love to place, sometimes it's a love to language, sometimes it's love to culture, sometimes it's a love to the partner that we share our life with. And in the case of the Lower Silesian Jews, it doesn't matter if they left or they stayed, there's a very strong love to the Lower Silesia. And then the question is why? Because this is not the original place where your whole family and your whole heritage is from. Niederschlesia was as a concept born in May 1945, and it remained until today for some, for those who decided to stay until May 2017. Why Lower Silesia is a theme for many people around the world. And I got into conclusion that if you have a full generation of people, as we did have in Poland, between 1945 and 1968, then this is enough time to create deep connection to the place, people, buildings, culture, whatsoever creates and constitutes the life. So I decided to call my project Love in the Ruins, because we still talk about ruins. People who survived alone, they build new life, but it's not the same life. It's life in that sense in ruins that you are the only one person who is standing and is holding your own history and is passing this and transmitting this to the next generation. Many people with whom I spoke in Israel found their own real love, real relationship in Lower Silesia, in kibbutz or orphanage house or at school. By surviving this difficult time of not having parents but already having freedom and new life, becoming first friends and later partners in life. They were finding themselves in kibbutzim in Israel, and they simply decided to stay together. Most of the couples that I have met still speak Polish to each other, which was very moving to me when I heard them saying, Kochanie, my beloved, my love. And speaking to me fluent Polish as if they just left Poland yesterday. And I had to remind myself that they did this 50 years ago. To this extent, this language is in great shape. These two faces you may know because Lower Silesian people are also in Berkeley. Szymon Dobrzeński and Róża Herszkowicz. Róża Herszkowicz told me that when she arrived to Wrocław, Wrocław was still in fire. It was early 1946, and she was with her parents. She was one of those lucky people who survived in the Soviet Union, as Szymon also. Róża is from Wrocław, but Szymon was from Dzierżoniów, and he had a great story to share about his school life in the heart of Dzierżoniów until 1948, when the whole family decided to leave. Róża left in 1968 due to the anti-Semitism in Poland, supported by the government, unfortunately, with a great help of Poles who decided to take active part in government's decision. It's another great shame for Poland to lose high educated people in that shameful year of 1968, when lawyers, doctors, ballet school teachers, opera singers, film teachers, school teachers, translators, and many others doing very important work, like for example architects and engineers, left Poland with one-way ticket, and after crossing the border, becoming displaced people with no citizen and no place to go, and only hoping that they won't be put into the prison by being illegal. And this is something what I also learned from the oral history, that it is possible to be citizen of one place, and suddenly after 20 years of building a safe, happy, looking like promising life, having great job, wonderful, promising career. Róża was chief of the pediatry, the only one Jewish woman in her hospital, and playing a very important role in the whole Lower Silesia, because she worked for the county hospital. You may be expelled from your place. That's why I decided to take active place in the memory, and with my university friends, teachers, inspired by people who decided to help with building this project that I am working on, the Lower Silesia, we decided to preserve the history of the place, including all the voices, Polish, German, Jewish. My focus is on the Jewish side because of my love to Yiddish that I'm always using as an excuse to come to people's homes, have a cup of tea and have a long conversation, often in Polish language, that always brings great joy to me and also breaks my heart, because I really would love to have these people as my neighbors when I was growing up in this country of Poland. But we have what we have, and we have to take the best from this what we can.